Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Wherever you are, we warmly welcome you to this webinar series. So the subject of this webinar series is procurement and tendering. But today, we'll be focusing on procurement methods in construction industry. We have an excellent resource person today who has been in the industry for more than 35 years and who is also one of the steering committee members of AIQA's UAE chapter. He is none other than Mr. Lokitha Karavita. He is also one of the chartered quantity surveyors. And without further ado, let me invite Mr. Lokitha Karavita to conduct this session. Mr. Karavita, over to you.
Thank you very much, Dulita. Can you hear me now? All?
Clear.
Yeah, okay. First of all, good evening, and I must thank Dulita Dharmaratna and his team from Colombo organizing this webinar in the ample time. And at the same time, I must thank Sukun Nirman for his technical support, and he is the person behind teaching me how to operate the Zoom. Right, I must special thanks to Sukun. Right. We'll move to the subject straight away. Today we are going to discuss about the procurement and tendering, right? And especially this session is dedicated for only procurement, right? And these slides I have catered or prepared based on the RICS and APC competencies based on. Now, if you look at the RICS, it called T062, procurement and tendering. It's a core competency under the level three. Now, if you go to the AIQAs, it's go as a core competency again, right? And the contract documentation and procurement. So if you are getting ready, right, I'm trying to explain theoretical aspect and how you can apply in the practical approach, right? But this theory part, when you are in the junior level, you can understand, but when you come to the senior level, you can adjust and adapt to the situation. Okay, and there is no hard and fast rule. These are the guidelines for the procurement. Now, before I proceed further, first of all, you should understand what is the difference between procurement word and the procurement strategy. Now, most of the cases, initially, when we talk about, we say procurement. Actually, when we were young, we understand procurement means buying something, right? Like a procurement, buying spare parts, something, the goods. This is just a procurement. But here, the procurement means procurement in construction. So it's called procurement strategy, right? Which is an action plan starting from, it's a delivery, project delivery system, starting from the inception until the project completion. Now, you cannot do single alone. You have to have a working arrangement, then the contract types. You have to understand the form of contracts and the tendering process. I'm not going to touch the tendering process today. It's a lengthy matter. We'll talk about that in the next stage. Now, first, you should understand what is the difference between procurement strategy and the tendering. Now, this definition I have taken from the RICS procurement and tendering page. It's clearly mentioned procurement is the overall act of obtaining goods and services from external source. An example of a building contractor and include deciding the strategy on how those goods are to be acquired, reviewing client requirement. Now, tendering is part of this procurement strategy, okay? The other thing I just want to mention, right, why we go for a procurement or why we go for a procurement strategy, right? We want to get the best product and deliver on time with the quality. Now, if you don't fulfill those things, right, you cannot have a good procurement action plan. Now, as an example, if you take it, right, initially, now, when you are studying, especially for the AIQS and RICS, this procurement and tendering, you should understand, like you're working for the client entity or the consultants. Okay. Now, if you are working for the construction contractor, don't worry, you do the same thing in your entity as well. Selection of the subcontractor or the subcontractors, you follow the same process. But when you are doing the studies towards to the RICS or the AIQAs, right, you must act as advisor to the client. That is what they are looking for. So keep it in mind, I always advise any quantity surveyor to start their job in the construction field, because there are a lot of activities happening in the construction field, and then you can move it to the consultants or developer or the client office. That's the way we brought up. So since we started in the construction as well, right, we didn't have any problem when we came to the consultant's office. We know all the construction technology and the way the process is happening. And if you look at the whole syllabus when it comes to the RICS and AIQS, this is the simplest subject. Okay, but only thing, you should understand the fundamental or theoretical side and how you are going to apply these things in day-to-day manner. After that, you never forget in your life, right? Start with the simple thing. Like before that, I'll go to the next slide. Now, this is the whole procurement strategy. We can divide into either three aspects or four aspects. Now, first one is the working arrangement, okay? And that I'm going to explain one by one in the latter part. And then you have to understand what are the contract types, which is the payment mechanism. Then you have to look at how you select the proper contractor, because you have to select the right contractor for the right job, right? If you select the wrong contractor or not confident contractor, the whole project get failed. And in the same time, you have to understand what sort of a form of contract you are going to use within this whole aspect. Project strategy. So each and every item, working arrangement, contract type, tendering, form of selection of form contract, all are equally essential, right? And when you come to the industry, like sometimes when you're working for the consultant, you treat the contractor like an enemy. That is the wrong concept. I always fight with that. And my idea is, if contractor succeeded, right, then that credit comes to you as well. So don't treat the contractor as an enemy if you are working for the consultants, and go with them and have a collaboration or internal relationship between the parties. So that is the key area I just want to touch. We'll go to we have to understand why procurement is important in construction. Now, say, assuming that simple, we get the simple example. Say you are a client, right? You have a money, or you're thinking to build up a house, right? What you do? First, you are thinking whether I have money, okay? Then what you do? You go and get the bank loan. Say you have five million rupees or whatever, 5 million rupees in hand. Then you are thinking, okay, when I need this, right, then you are thinking, okay, I have a time plan. Then you are thinking whether I have to have this 5 million I'll use for the quality job or just a building. There are houses vary from the normal construction and to the super luxury level, right? So then what you do, you go and appoint somebody, because who you are, as a client, you are a layman, right? Since you are in the construction industry, you know someone. But initially, any client, what he does is he appoints the architect, right? Then he does the design, okay? Then he gives his responsibilities to architect or the designer. Say, okay, these are my prime concerns. I have money. I'm targeting my the project to be delivered on this date. Or I need the super luxury, better finishes, right? So based on that only, this procurement strategy has to be decided. Then you think about where you are going to put up this house, whether it's within the Colombo or the city area or the remote area. Then you have to look at the regulatory, the authority requirement. It is one to other is changing. Then you have to think about what are the risks available, right? Now think about if you want to put up a house in middle of city, heart of the city, then the site conditions are completely different. But if it is away, remote area, right, the completely different site conditions. Now move into the constructability and the buildability. Now there are cases you depend on the contractor to build, or you depend on architect to design the whole job. So those are the areas you have to look at. And then we look at what are the technical advancement. So there are risks in the construction. If you look at the whole industry, the construction industry is the riskiest industry. Then we have to think about how to mitigate, how to control the risk, and how do you manage the risk. That's one of the key areas. So these are the areas we are going to talk about it, and I will take one by one. Now, if cost, the cost, time, quality is the three parameters we have to look at, and it is vary one project to other. And then the major thing is in construction, we are transferring the risk from one party to other party, right? It is dependent on the procurement delivery system, right? Based on that, we have to select the right procurement delivery system. Now, if you get the major concerns, now we talk about what is the cost, the time, and the quality. When we have these three parameters, then we have to look at the client's risk-taking ability. Some clients, they are willing to take the risk, right? And like you are in the field, you know, okay, instead of the supervisor, you go and supervise. Now, if you don't know the supervision, or you don't have a construction technology knowledge, what you do? You transfer that into another party. Then you look at the complexity of the project. Sometimes you need a small house. Sometimes you need a complex house, three-story, multi-story building, and swimming pool, and garden. The same thing, think about in the larger scale, like a shopping development, or the larger development, like a airport, or the seaport, Fort City. Those are the larger projects. Right? Think about the small first, and then move into the higher requirements. Now then, you have to think about whether any time I can get into the project and carry out the variations, right? If I want to change anything, whether I'm able to change, and what cost. Okay, as a client, how far I can get involved with the job. Sometimes the client is there, architect never allow you to get in, right? And you need the different type of house, and you have visuals in your mind, but architect produce, or the designer produce, completely different other than you expected. Those are the things you have to look at, right? Then you have to segregate from the design from the management. Those are the major areas you have to think before you get into any picture. Right. Now, when it comes to the project delivery system, right, there are aspects you have to look at, right? The major delivery systems are there. One is the traditional path. Second one is the design and build path. Third one is the management path. The fourth one is the design and management path. Now, when it comes to the traditional path, where we got this? Actually, what happened was this is the only system we know ages ago, because it has inherited from the UK. When Britishers, they brought anything to Sri Lanka at that time, 1940s, 50s, they had only traditional path, right? They never come across the other paths. And the good old days, the architect is the key person. Architect, under the architect, there are so many designers used to work. And the all other bodies work under the one architect. So they prefer to go for a traditional path, And traditional path also had the accelerated method and the sequential method. I will explain the slides one by one. Then in Sri Lanka, those days we had the public works department. It's called Weda Departamentua. Buildings department, right? Those are the two entities we had it, when I talk about the history. But then after the Second World War II, then the UK want to develop the projects quickly. And they were using the traditional path, and it took ages to finish the project. Then they didn't have any options. What they did was they were looking for anybody to finish the projects in a simple way. Then from US, there was a team came and they introduced, okay, we are a XYZ company and we will do the design and build method. And they didn't allow, initially debated because they cannot understand. And eventually, the couple of projects they had given to that particular company and they completed those projects successfully. From that day onwards, design and build part came to the picture. Then eventually, now we move to the management part. Management part also we divide into the management of contracting and the construction management. So the last one is the design and manage part. That's another entity. I will take one by one and explain. Now when it comes to the contract types, right, we have the lump sum contracts, and especially when it comes to the traditional, you always knows the how to, what is the remeasure contract. Okay, then you get the lump sum contract, then cost reimbursement contracts. I'll just glance and explain one by one later. Okay, when it comes to the form of contract, right, in the UAE, most of the people we are using FIDIC contracts or bespoke. In Sri Lanka, I know ICTAD and various other entities, they have introduced a various form of contracts. But when you are getting ready for the RICS or the AIQS, they may consider the what sort of condition of contract you are using currently. But at least you should understand or the basics, what is FIDIC. Okay, and the JCT is generally used in UK. Other one is International Condition of Contracts. There are NECs, and the most of the places in UAE we use bespoke, but those contracts it's derived from FIDIC 1987 or 1999. So far, I have not seen that anybody is using FIDIC 2017 version. Okay, now when it comes to the tendering, I'm not going to touch today. There are open tendering, single stage selective tendering, two stage tendering, and the negotiated tendering. So that I will cover in the second slot. So we'll talk about today the procurement. Basically, these are the four areas. We'll take the traditional path. Now, when it comes to the traditional path, okay, the simple way of explanation is client appoint the consultant to design. Okay, the design responsibility with aligning with the contract or client, and then when the project design is complete, we go for a bidding. It takes time. Then after that, we select the suitable contractor to carry out the work. Now, how do you select the team? So the client has always advisors, like he appoint his own team, right? Then he develop the design and do the complete design package until the package suitable for the construction. Now there are advantage and disadvantage in this scenario, right? Now definition, the client employ a consultant to design the works for bid and build by the contractor. Consultant supervise the construction stage and certify the completed work. Now, when it comes to this traditional path, right, we always use the FIDIC grade book, either 1987 or 1999, or any other suitable condition of contract, you can use it. Now, what are the advantages? Now, this method, we all know, very well understood, practiced, tested, positive. We don't have any problem, right? Now, the quality is controlled by the client and his team, right? And design is 100% a client's responsibility. Now, the advantage is he can do enter into during the construction, he can do the anytime the variation the way he wants. So, but it's a costly matter. So the sequence is design complete and then go for a bidding purpose, then the selected the contractor, right? Most of the cases we select the contractor based on the technical capabilities, and we select the suitable contractor based on the merits. But in this part of the world, we go for a technically acceptable lowest bidder. But I'm not challenging, but that is not the right way. Sometimes you get the technically higher, get the higher marks, but they are not the lowest. But you had, when you evaluate, you have to understand what is his capabilities and what is the delivery time. Those are the major areas, right? Now the one of the advantages is the cost. If you talk about the cost certainty, right? Cost, some people there's cost certainty is there, right? But cost certainty will come to know the what is the final cost. They come to know when the contract is awarded to the contractor, right? Assuming that there is no variations, but if the variations are there, right? Final account, when it comes to the final account only, we know the final, what is the final cost. So the disadvantage, what are the disadvantages? Now look at the design. Who is doing the design? Client has done the design, okay? Now contractor is not responsible, okay? Contractor is for the construction. So he say, okay, you have done the design. My job is to do the construction. So there is no single party taking the responsibility for the build, design responsibility. Now, when it comes to the advanced methods, there are ways you can transfer that towards the contractor at cost. Now, what we do is sometimes we do the traditional part, right? This is out of the box. And then when we prepare the tender document, we put another clause, contractor verify and validate the design. And then you have to pay the cost so that you can do it. But theoretically, there is no single responsibility. The architect is designing and he is taking the responsibility, or the design team, or the client. So another disadvantage is longer duration, right? You have to complete the design, then the bidding period. Look at the time consuming. So because of that, there are some people, they don't like this one. Right, so because contractor is not getting involved from the day one. Now there are two systems we call sequential. Sequential means contractor appoint after the completion of the full design. Okay, that's a standard method everybody using. Now the acceleration method means some projects you want to hand out. You need to appoint the contractor right in the as soon as the part of the design is finished, then you can appoint, then the other packages, you can use it as the provisional sums. I'll give a good example. Say you want to have a multi-story building, okay, 10-story building. Now while the designing, your client is pushing, okay, I need to tender this job. But MEP work is not ready. What are you going to do? So you assume certain parameters, and then that one you transfer into the, as a packages, as a provisional sums. So then you can get the contractor on board as soon as the skeleton is finished or the structure is finished and the finishers, then the packages or the MEP work, you can tender or you can use as a provisional sums at the later stage. So that's pretty simple. So many people, they use the acceleration method in addition to the sequential method. Hope it is clear, right? The time I had run. Now the design and build path. This is one of the unique one nowadays everybody is using. There are advantages and disadvantages. Now, see the definition. Client procure the complete product from the contractor with complete design and building. Design and build is a fast track strategy by transferring risk to the contractor, and client loses some control over the project. Okay, so that's a definition. Now, when it comes to this case, most of the client, what they want to get the contractor early engaged. That is why they select this sort of design and build path to accommodate his job to finish quickly as possible. So the design responsibility client is transferring from client to the designer, the contractor. Okay, that's the one of the advantage. This sort of design and build contractors are available in this part of the world, and even in Sri Lanka, right? Sometimes they have a joint ventures. Okay, say you want to construct the 100,000 bed hospital, you go for a design and build. What you have to do is you have to select the right contractor who has a sense of the design entity within their company. If not, most of the cases, what they do is they have a joint venture, right? Contractor and the consultants or the designer, they have a joint venture, and then they bid. Now, when it comes to the design and build, right? Most of the cases, client has he prepared the brief scope of work, and then he may have a budget, and then he try to appoint the contractor immediately based on a brief scope of work, right, or the concept design, right? So when we appoint the contractor, there are advantages and disadvantages are there, right? Now, most of the one we are using at the moment, we are doing the design and build contract because it's easy for us, right? We give the concept design to the contractor, or we go for a bidding and then get the number of contractors to bid and get the best design out of the design and build contractors. Okay. This method saves the time, right? It's a shorter period because initially, you are not spending the longer duration for the designing work, right? So that's one of the key area. Client prepare the brief scope of work, and then he has a quality control plan, HSE plan, and prepare the schedule of your unit rates and transfer into the contractor for bidding purpose. So then they come back with the lump sum price of the totals of package for the whole job. So what are the advantage? Now, from the day one, right, immediately when the tender award, we have a firm price. Okay, before the construction start, we know the price. Now, who is taking the responsibility of the construction or the design responsibility? It is lying with the contractor. He is taking the full responsibility. Now, how about the time? No bidding process time, right? Because of that, no design time, the time also less, right? The buildability, this contractor is a specialized contractor. He knows how to construct the best way because we are selecting the specialist contractors. Now, they know their job better than the client team, right? And the cost certainty is there. Now, the only thing is there will be a design gaps when they are designing, right? So to avoid that, what client does is client appoint his own team separately as their agent to supervise this contractor's design construction work, and they are going to review their design. So because of that, this method is quite famous, and the client is transferring his whole responsibility to another party. Okay, what are the disadvantages, right? Cost of the projects goes up because there are so many unknowns, right? Because initially, client has given the design brief. Based on that, contractor has given the design, and they carry on the design. And there are many unknowns, but end of the day, the project has to be fit for the purpose. Now, always I take the 1,000-bed hospital, right? If you go for a bidding, right, you select the three contractors, you say, okay, I have a plot, 2 hectares or four acres or whatever, and then I need the 1,000-bed hospital. I have a budget of maybe 500 million. Sometimes they give the parameters, then they come with the full design. And then sometimes they can design the horizontal way, the 1,000-bed hospital, or the vertical, the horizontal or the vertical, both ways, right? It's depend on architect to architect or the designer to design, how they can deliver the project. Okay, understand the at least the concept, right? Then after that, client is having a very difficult time for selection of the right contractor. Then they have the design review team or the jury, and then based on the design, nowadays we have 3Ds, and depend on the design or the accessibility, then they select the right contractor on the time. So the one of the major disadvantages, the variation cannot be done. I cannot say no. You can do the variation, you can give an instruction at any point, but the initially they have given the lump sum price, right? Because of that, the variation will be costly, okay? To avoid that, most of the cases what we do is, we ask contractor to give the unit rates. Now, if you want to do any variation, we have a lump sum price for the whole project, and then when it comes to the variation, we use the unit rates which they have given. As I mentioned, it's pretty hard to difficult to compare the bids, right? Design is controlled by the contractor. The client doesn't have any authority to change the design. If they change the design, it would be costly, right? And there are three methods of selection of the design and build contractor. Sometimes you go call the one item we call single entry. Single entry means client has the reputed contractors or the design and build contractors. They call them and straight away they say, okay, I have a job, give us a price. Right? This is my parameters, like 1,000-bed hospital, you name it, the mortuary, you need the emergency wards, and the nurses' quarters, doctors' quarters, and like that, they keep dotting down their requirement. Talk about the single entry selection of the one bidder, right, without any competition. Like, then we move to the competitive entry, mean selection on the design and build contractor based on the competitive bidding. It's like when you come to 1,000-bed hospital, they go for with the design brief, and then client requests 3-4 bidders to bid for the job, and then after that they select the best possible contractor based on the various aspects they are looking at: the cost, time, and the quality of the job, and aesthetic view. That is one of the key area they are looking at, and the project logistic. And sometimes these contractors coming from all over the world, and they are looking at who are the reputed contractors who can get it bought quickly as possible. Now the development construction means there's another concept, right? Client, this sort of a development construct goes for like a heavy engineering work, similar like a sewage treatment plant, nuclear plants, oil and refinery, and currently I'm working with the Abu Dhabi Power Corporation, and we are doing the development construct because there are many unknowns are there. What we do is transmission of the heavy power and the water from the reservoir, especially the water from the desalination plant to the nearest pumping station, right? There are so many unknowns. Because of that, we do a concept design, right? And we call front-end engineering design or the FEED. So we ask consultant to do the FEED, and then we ask contractor to do the FEED development and construction. So that is called development construct, right? The this sort of things are happening in the most of the this part of the world, because the unknowns are many than the knowns. Like this sort of contract, there's a clause we always put, fit for the purpose, right? So because of that clause, we are trying to avoid the variation coming up. Like 1,000-bed hospital, when they are designing, we need everything, right? And the function has to be, there should be minimum 1,000-bed and all the other amenities, whatever the required, it has to be within their design. So you cannot argue, we have mess and this is a variation, no more variation. It's a lump sum fixed price job from the day one. So those are the major things if you look at the design and build part. One of the key areas is transferring the design responsibility from client to the contractor. The advantage is, one of the key advantages is shorter duration, but the cost is high, because the contractor is pricing all the unknowns and they have to give up, they are giving a high price. And to avoid that, we do the negotiation as well. So that is the way we are trying to bring down the cost to the reasonable levels. Now I'll move to the management contracting. So when you come to the management part, there are two ways. One is the management contracting, and the other one is construction management. So don't get mixed it up with these two. There are major differences. So most of the time when you go for RICS or APC, IQS, APC interviews, they ask questions from this part, right? And when they ask a management contracting question, you answer the construction management answers. So because of that, don't get mix it up with these two, right? Management contracting is used for the very complex project, right? From the day one, client appoint the management contractor, right? That is the one of the key. So what he does is, he is giving the advice to the client. In the same time, he controls all the work packages under the client's their directions. See the definition which I have taken from RICS competencies. Client, along with the project manager, appoint the management contractor, and management contractor advises the client on programming and buildability. Work divided into services of package on the lump sum basis. Package can start soon as client approves the design. Management contractor on standard fee. So everything is covered over there. Client, what they do is, this sort of a mechanism they use for the complex project, right? And I can get especially like airport projects or the shopping complexes with the residential towers, larger projects with many packages are involved, right? Especially the good one is the Mattala Airport. When they did the construction, there was a lot of package contractors. I believe they have used the management contracting practice, because the client appoint the management contractor, right? And then management contractor, they divide the projects into the various packages, and he controls everything. But in theoretically, practically what is happening is, this management contractor, though he called management contractor, right? Most of the cases, we appoint the PMC, project management consultants, who can do who can control all the contractors under the one belt. Sometimes the international management contractors are there. They take the couple of packages and they do the construction work. In the same time, they are looking after the other package contractors as well. But I have seen many cases we are using now, right? What we do is, we appoint the, as a client, we appoint the management PMC consultants or the contractor to carry out all the other package contracts. Right. The question comes, now these packages, who is preparing? The management contractor or PMC people, they are preparing the packages, and they go for a bidding, and they do the designing, bidding, and everything. But when it comes to the signing of the contract, that's the beauty. Sometimes, theoretically, they sign the, only the signing contract with the client directly. Okay, but case by case, client is giving the authority for management contractor to take the responsibility. They are transferring that responsibility also to the management contractor to sign the contract between the parties. Okay, don't get mix it up. Okay, client has his, though he appoint the management contractor, in the same time he has advisors, right? He himself has his project managers and the client consultants, separate team, because nowadays nobody trusts each other. So they will advise client. In the same time, management contractor also advises the client. Okay, so one of the advantages in the, as soon as there is any package is complete, design work is finished, then immediately you can allow contractor to board and start the construction work. So that's called early start and the early completion, especially the enabling packages. Now the client is expecting this management contractor to control all the projects, right? And he is expecting his know-how transfer into all the other contractors, right? Now the other thing is client able to carry out any changes at any level, right? It's a costly matter, but sometimes the client prefer this sort of a package way, right? This is used by the large the projects, right? You can work parallelly, right? The work packages can be tendered separately, one by one, as soon as the design is complete, because these packages are not interconnecting. Though it's interconnecting, you can segregate, right? The other one is when it comes to the insurance also, sometimes the management contractor, they take the whole insurance for the whole project, right? And because if you try to get the insurance by one, these package contractors, cost goes up. So because of that, client advice management contractor to take the one umbrella insurance package for this sort of a case. Now the disadvantage, if the management contractor fails, okay, due to his manpower or his knowledge, and whole project get disturbed. And that's one of the key area. That is why when it comes to the management contractor, they select the right person paying high price. It's costly affair. Okay. We have seen the management contractors are failing, and sometimes when they run away, the whole project is in the shambles. So the client is in the jeopardy, and because the client doesn't know what to do with that leftover, and then they have to appoint another management contractor. So when we are selecting a management contractor, we are going for various scrutinies, and then management contractor sign a separate agreement with the client. It's called the PSC, professional service agreement. So that's the way management contractor get paid. Most of the management contractors get paid based on the percentage, right, agreed between parties based on the whole project, right? So when you use the management contracting, the management contractor's cost is high because he has to employ a lot of people to look after each and every package, right? Because nothing comes free, right? Now, if the packages are large, you have to have a different project managers, right? Quantities are available separately. So because of that, the management contract is the fees is high, and overall project cost also goes up. That is why we use when it comes to the larger projects. Okay. Now we'll go to the construction management. It's a completely different one, right? Now in this one, client has a ability to sign the direct link keep the direct link with the package contractors, right? What client does is initially he appoint the construction manager, okay? But construction manager act as another person, right? And he's supporting the client and advising from the day one, from the appointment onwards. But he is not directly involved with these package contractors, okay? Client directly engage with the package contractors, and he prefer give a direct instruction and lace with the direct relations between the parties. Now, the what does client do? Client, they appoint the project manager and client's designers. They do the design based on the packages. When the packages finish, they immediately award it to the package contractors. They can again the start the job at any time when the packages are ready. So construction manager always supporting the client and advising, right? They understand the relationship. Now, the previous case, if you go back, management contractor has a direct link with the package contractors. Client doesn't have a direct link, okay? But here, client has a direct link with these package contractors, right? Construction manager not coming to the picture, and he is advising to the client. See the definition. Client appoint the construction manager at early stage on the fee basis, and construction manager advises the client. The client contracts directly with various trade contractors. Actually, this method is practiced in UK long ago. I never come across this sort of thing except once the different country while I was working, and then they appointed the construction manager. He used to come to the site and give the instruction to he's looking at the safety and the quality aspect, but he go and complain to the client saying that there's an incident, and then client project team directly get involved. So he's like a terror. I mean, they're advising, they're giving the right to advising to the client. So the advantage, construction manager has to be a qualified person and always advising. He has a direct employee relationship between the client, and he get paid again the either lump sum fee or the percentage basis. In this case, if the construction manager fails, many people say project can be in jeopardy, but I don't think construction manager fails. Okay, somewhat there's a link, but client has the project manager and clients to advise, then client has his own team to support. But most of the theoretically says construction manager fail or the project fail. So the client is always depend on the construction manager in this case. Now, even the sequence, you can see the design, you don't have to complete the full design. When the part of the design is finished, or the enabling packages, you can start at any time. So that's the beauty of it. They're similar to the previous one we call management contracting. As soon as the work packages finish, you can get the contract on board. Okay. Now the other one is design and manage one, right? It's called the design and manage part. This is the definition. This is a combination of the design and build management part. The client appoint a single firm to design the project and manage the construction work, but specialist contractors are appointed to carry out the work. Now this sort of a case, employer appoint the design and build contractor similar to the previous design and build case, but here directly the design is done by them and managed by them as well, right? The client has his own scope designer, right? Then he support the employer and then transfer his design to the design and manage contractor. Then they appoint the designer as well as the contractor. So this sort of this is a theoretical part only, but I never come across this sort of method, right? But we have to learn this method also. Advantage is the single point responsibility, employer transferring the design responsibility to the design and manage contractor. It is time saving. Definitely buildability is there because we appoint the right contractor to carry out the design and construction. So look at the disadvantage, not widely understood in the region. That is why I said I never come across this design and manage part. and the quality is a concern, but that also can be managed if the employer appoint his scope designer and another design team. So you can rectify that, right? But the and the other thing is, employer doesn't have a direct contractual control because it is controlled by the design and manage contractor. So those are the major areas we have to discuss about the design and procurement part. Now, in addition to that, I want to explain a little bit about the other aspects of the procurement, right? And previously, I don't think people discuss about this, but there are types of contracts, right? We call term contracts. Now, most of the term contracts is like you get the schedule of rates from the contractor, and then as and when required, the contractor comes and do the work based on the unit rates. Like especially the when you come to the demolition, like your house, you want to alter something, you don't know where you end up with. So you keep the schedule of rates, then you select the contractor and agree the rates, and whenever the work is completed, and then you pay on time. Now the other one is a call of contract. Now this sort of a contract we are using generally for our work, right? Especially for the during the plant operations, the shutdowns. What we do is we have a three or four contractors. We get the rates for the various activities, and we lock the rates, right? And sometimes the rates one to other is different, right? But what we try to do is we try to normalize and give a one the agreed price for the all three contractors. If not, we keep the three different rates. Now that rate is valid for a certain period, like normally we sign the contract for 3 years, and but we call them in advance during the shutdown only. Like when it comes to the oil and gas industry, the refinery shutdown happened maybe one time a year, maybe that period, maybe 2 weeks. So 3-4 months earlier, we advise the contractor, okay, you get ready with the labor, manpower, equipment and everything, and stand by. And exactly on the shutdown day, we ask them to get into the job, and we give the work orders. And then they carry out the work based on the agreed rates. So that is called the call of contract. Then the other one is the serial contracts. Agreed the price based on the similar contract. Like in this part of the world, we signed the schools are here, it's identical, right? If you look at the same model, we have a model A, B, C. We agree one rate for the one school, and then they price, and we sign the contract with the contractors for the construction of the model A building, model A school. Then if there's another school comes in the different location, we ask them to construct the same school in the same price. Now the argument is, now the soil condition and things are changed. So we pay different prices depending on the area to area, okay? And the other one is the continuation of the contracts, like the certain contracts we signed, like cleaning, right? For the duration of the 1 year or 2 year, right, until the next contract signed, we ask them to continue for another year, so at the same rates. So the other one is a framework for the prime contracts. This one is used in the UK, especially in the military, right? But you should know at least the background. And what happened was the good old days when it comes to defense, they agreed with the contractor the rates, and whenever they needs whatever essential work, they have to supply the material on agreed rates. So to read about what is prime contracts, right? It's a long-term price agreements signed in the UK defense. The other one is I want to talk about the blanket agreement. Like we have this sort of a contract, like if you want to, we sign with the recruitment agencies for 3 years, and we say we need the quantity surveyors or the contracts engineers or architects or the designers, and we say, okay, this is our rate, and we agreed the rate from the beginning of the contract, and we sign with the 3-4 recruitment agencies, and we lock the price for 3 years. Whenever we need, we said okay, we send the work order and say we need the two contracts engineers or two quantity surveyors. Please provide from this date to this date and as agreed rates. So then they provide. So those called blanket contracts. The other one is, I'm just touching these areas because one day you needed this, right? And now we are signing the service level contracts or service level agreements. Now, those are the special cases like software. Now, when we buy the hundreds of PCs, what will happen? So we initially signed the contract to supply and install 100 computers. So their contract is finished. So after that, we signed another contract for after installation until another 3 years or 4 years, they have to give a backup service, software license, and whenever emergency required, they have to come and rectify the issues. So that's called service level contract. Now, at the moment, we are negotiating with our existing original equipment manufacturers, this bit of advanced thing. And there are certain companies who build the substations. Now, every time when there is a shutdown, we have to buy the spare parts from them. Instead of that, what we now we are doing is we are negotiating. They have to do a health check and they have to give a lump sum price for next 3 years. Okay, these are the spares required and we will agree to supply and install these spares on an emergency. So this is a bit of a complex matter, but I would just want to touch. One day you may come to know. By that time, at least you can refer to these notes if you are in the junior level. Now, the latest one, they have introduced is the captive corporate contracts. So this is the unique one now, established. Employer, they themselves establish the construction company as well. So they have a tie-up, the various developers, they tie up with the contractor and they large contractors, and then when there is work is going on, they segregate the packages and they ask their own contracting company to build. So it's a single source, no more competition, no more bidding. They maybe have agreed rates. Based on that, they can do the construction work. Like there are a couple of companies I have mentioned, Sama Dubai and EC Harris is another joint venture. Alda and Lane Norak is another entity. Like that, there are so many developers. They have their own client and the construction company joint ventures. Okay, at least you should know a little bit about these words. Now, the other one is, I just want to talk about the partnering. It's a partnering is the good one. The understanding between the parties, right? Look at the definition, improving public service through a better construction. Partnering is a set of strategic action which embody the mutual objectives of the number of firms achieved by cooperative decision-making aims at using feedback to continuously improve their joint performance. Partnering is a collaborative approach, right? They may be two parties or three parties or three, four parties together. They sign the contract, have a general understanding to finish the product or delivery project on time without any ambiguity. One of the advantages this partnering is there won't be any court cases because all these three or four parties know their entity and the limitations and the responsibilities clearly mentioned beginning of the contract. So based on that, they work for the one goal to finish the project. Now the one is the PPP, we call public private partnership. So there are so many examples I can give. One good example is the Colombo Port City. I came to know recently they have a tri-party agreement, they call it a triple P agreement, and they are successfully moving, right? And the Colombo government and the Chinese government and the contractors together, they have signed the contract and they are working for betterment of the future. And some countries, they have the toll roads, the A1 highway, right? Maybe you can be funded by some government. Okay, initially the project is belongs to that country, the funder or the China or whatever, whoever the financial institute. And then after some time, they will hand over back to the particular government. So this is PFI is quite common nowadays. It's happening in the all over the world, especially in the third world countries. Now it's like China moving to the Africa, and most of the countries they sign the PPP or PFIs, right? Private finance initiatives, right? And this because of that, is both parties are getting advantages. Now this is sketch I have taken from the books, the typical project structure for PPP. It's called project special project or vehicle or SPC, and then you get the lenders giving support, investors are there, equities, project finance, and so many parties get involved, right? And after that, the engineering contractor comes to the picture, and the operator, and so many people are coming into the picture, and one main goal is to finish the finish and deliver the project on successful way. So this is the PPP engagement, and everybody is getting benefited, right? So this is the chart I have taken from the slide, another book. If you go through this whatever the procurement strategy is, traditional or management or the construction, design and build, when you use it, it's clearly mentioned what are the advantages and disadvantages, right? Now, in our company or the government entity, as soon as we get the initial brief scope work, and then at that day itself, we go through the requirements and we look at the client's requirement, and whether it's a time-consuming matter, or this has to be delivered on time, or the time is essential, or the cost is the priority, or the quality is priority. Based on that, we select from the right procurement strategy from the day one. So based on that, only the project will move forward. So this procurement strategy has to be select, not halfway through, is from the day one. If not, the project get failed. Okay. Now we talk about the contract types, and there are few contract types. As a content reserve, we all know what is remeasured contract. So initially, architects or the designer prepare the drawings. Based on that, quantities survey take off the quantities, and end of the project, and it's remeasuring. Right, and contractors get paid at the actual quantities based on the final BOQ. But one advice I'll give to young quantity surveyors: when you are measuring the BOQs, make sure the accuracy is there. Nowadays, contractors are not trusting the consultants' QSs because they can make errors by mistake or genuinely. When we take off the quantities, previously, when we do the quantity takeoff, we didn't have a mobile or anything, and we were focusing. It's like a meditation, right? Nowadays, you look at the mobile and then WhatsApp messages, and you don't know where you stop the measuring, right? And suddenly you think, okay, concrete, I measured the 20 meter cubes, I had another five, round it up, and then start again. And like that, now the problem comes when it comes to the full detailed design is those drawings goes to the contractor for pricing, and then they remeasure, and then they challenge. Then you have to prove that your quantities are right, or then if it is wrong, you have to accept that you have made a mistake. Now the other one is a lump sum contract, right? And the lump sum contract means there is no remeasure. The the contract and client agreed for the whole project was lump particular sum, right? And this is not subject to remeasure, right? And the how the most of the design and build project, and we cannot prepare the BOQ. What we do is we prepare the BOQ based on the elements, like say a 1,000-bed hospital. I mean, what are the what is the BOQ? You get the preliminary design general matter, then the you can have the bill for the ground underground work substructure, and then you can have a concrete structure and then finishes based on the elements, right? And then they give a lump sum price for those elements, right? And those are not subject to remission, but only for the comparison. When you do the commercial evaluation, you can review, right? The other one is the cost reimbursement contract. There are three types: fluctuation fee, fixed fee, and the percentage fee. Okay, I'll come to this one. Remission I talk about is lump sum I talk about. Cost reimbursement is for the ideal for the renovation projects. Now this this sort of a one is based on the initially agreed for the percentage of fee, right? Now the say the project value is 10 million, so then contractor and the client, they agreed the fees. Okay, whatever their profit margin or the overheads and profit is like a 10% or 20%. Whatever the price they agree, whatever the bills they pay, they get the percentage, right? Certain ones, they agreed for the fixed fee, right? And the fixed fee mean the whatever the price is there, there's a lump sum. Say it's a 10 million project, their fee is 2 million or 1 million, right? But the price goes up or down, it's fixed. There's some remaining unchanged, right? Most of the time, they try to keep it as it is. Okay, fluctuated fees mean when the cost goes up, right, fee reduce, right, and cost go down, fees increase, right, and the initially there's a project value, right, and they agree the some sort of percentage. Now the cost goes up, the fees get reduced, right, cost goes down, and then the fees increase, right, and the other one is that also divide into target cost plus. The target cost basically set early in the project, right? Now, if there's any cost saving or cost overrun, right, that gain or the pain is sharing by the parties, okay? Now, read about, I have attached more slides with that. Now, the most of the cases, right, the lump sum price is there. If the when the project is awarded, there's a lump sort of a sum, and the price goes up beyond that, right? And then the both parties are sharing pain, right? If there's a saving, right, both parties are going to share the reduction. Now, when it comes to the guarantee, is the maximum price, right? When the price is fixed, if it goes beyond, like if it is the project value is 10 million, contractor has to design and build project within that 10 million, right? That is the initially price they have agreed. Now the price goes up, then contractor has to pay, right? And that is the we call guaranteed maximum price. The contractor is responsible for the cost overrun. So that is the basically contract types and how we pay the contractor. Okay, there are some notes I added. You can read later. Okay, I'm not going to talk about that. Now we'll talk about the last area is the form of contract. We'll move to the last session, the form of contract. I mean, in the same time when you are selecting any project, the project delivery system, you have to select the right form of contract. And if you look at the FIDIC form of contract, if you are using, it's a fair and reasonable document, and it is advantage. Both parties are equally given the rights, right? So some people, they love to use the FIDIC contract, and if you use the FIDIC contract, the cost goes down because the parties' responsibilities are equally shared. But if you use the bespoke contract like us, we are using monopoly contracts, and we pay higher price because our contracts are catered to suit for our requirement, right? And when you are selecting same way the contractor, and beginning of the project, you have to select what sort of a form of contract you are going to use. Now, in the RICS and the AIQS, most of the time we talk about the selection of the FIDIC contracts, right? And here we are just touching, but when it comes to the contract administration, some other person will explain about the advantage and disadvantage of using the FIDIC contracts, right? And the clauses. But here, when it comes to the initial stage, right, the procurement strategies, right? And we talk about the FIDIC. Now, at least you know what are the differences between the FIDIC contract 87 version against the 92 version. Nowadays, they may ask the questions related to the 2017 version, right? Now, if you get the, I'll move to the next slide, right? FIDIC, FIDIC 87 issued, then after that 99, they revised. Especially there are rainbow colors. You go to the website and read about it, and then FIDIC 2017 introduced. Now red book, there's a yellow book and silver book, green book, and there are so many rainbow versions are there. These versions they have used for the various purposes. Most of us in the building industry, we have to use the red book, right? Now the condition of contract for construction, for building and engineering works designed by the employer, the people are using red book. Now, when it comes to the yellow book, is used for the design and build electrical and mechanical works. Now we are using our bespoke contract derived from yellow book, the 1987, but we changed the whole many clauses to fit into industry, and because we are in the client entity and we don't want to have any more claims, and our payment terms are different than the FIDIC, and the dates are different, and so much of changes in the contract, and we are protecting client, not the contractor. But when it comes to the FIDIC other books, right, the general books, it is protected, the client and the contractor both are protected equally. But when it comes to the bespoke contract, whoever using, right, it is mainly protected, the client protection, right? And no, you cannot have claims, and so many clauses change, but in the same time, we are paying the penalty, right? Because we don't want to have ambiguity, and it's a one way, and the way we want, your contractor has to work. That's a wrong concept. But that is what the bespoke most of the contracts catered. Now, when it comes to the silver book, right, it's used for the turnkey projects, right, and especially you should understand what is the green book. Green book is used for the short form of contract, and especially when there is no warranty get involved, right, and the value is less, duration has to be shorter, then you can use the green book. And there are blue book we call, and that is using for the dredging and reclamation. And sometimes when you go for an interview, suddenly they ask, the assessor asks, do you know what is the blue book used for FIDIC? And most of the people, they get stuck. And especially you should know what is the white book. White book is used by the consultants for the service, model service agreement, or the professional service of PSCS, and it's derived from this white book. So there's a gold book, and like that, there are so many versions, and you should understand what are the differences and in this form of contract. I'm going to touch, these are the last two, three slides. I will touch the, now the other one is the tendering. When it comes to the, nowadays we are using e-procurement. At least you should understand what is the difference between the manual e-procurement and the manual against the e-procurement. So most of the people are in Sri Lanka, is procurement tendering is done by manually, right? But here in the Middle East and the various other part of the world, many people are using the e-procurement, right? And there's a short, it has a short procurement cycle. Economically, you can use it, right? Internet-based procurement system. Now, the one of the key advantages is paperless, right? And you don't need the huge place for storing. Now, if you go to the manual, you have to prepare the documents manually, and it takes time, and there's a lot of manpower involved, and you have to deliver the tender document to the particular place for when the bids are closed. There are so many advantages and disadvantages are there. But in the e-procurement, one of the disadvantages, initially there is a cost involvement because the software and the maintenance costs are quite large. But if you invest for that, that's a long-term process, right? And the security concerns, so far we have seen security is protected, but God knows nowadays hackers and young people, they can enter wherever. And because of that, I cannot give any guarantee. So you should understand what is the difference between the manual tendering and the e-procurement. That's a completely new subject, but definitely when you come to the assessors, RICS and APC, they will touch. And if there's any courses available for e-procurement, go and join. So that is the future. Now, never had the webinars before. Now every day we are facing the webinars, because now no more personal interaction. Okay, I think e-procurement process I talk about, and then that's it for today. And now over to the Q&A session. I'm thinking I explained much as possible simple way, but I need longer period, right, if I go slow. And I will release these notes through the Tulita, and you can share with the others, and then you can read and understand, attend the more webinars, right, whoever conducting, and any language. And yesterday someone, Mr. Saman Velagedra, conducted the similar seminar, and he also explained, and attend more. And then after that, get the hands-on experience, then I'm sure you can easily get through this subject. And this is one of the easiest subject, I reckon, because there is no closest to remember. Only these procurement strategies to procurement path, you have to understand the bottom and proceed. And when you work with the contractor and try to move to the consultants, if you are working with the consultant, try to move to the contractor, and then you get the feelings and the mixed experience, and you can utilize. Thank you very much, and we'll move to the Q&A now.
So whoever is having any questions, you can raise hand and we'll unmute you, and subsequently you can raise your questions. At the meantime, there's one question in the chat box, Mr. Lokita. This has been raised by someone called Jack. So he's asking whether the SBD documents also share the same sort of responsibilities like you discussed in FEDIC.
Sorry, I couldn't get you.
He's asking whether the SBD documents which are in use in Sri Lanka, do they also share the same kind of responsibility amongst all parties and rights?
Well, frankly speaking, I have not gone through the Sri Lankan documents for last 20, 30 years, and I cannot give that answer. But SBD document, I believe they have prepared based on the equal both parties sharing the responsibilities, because it's produced by the government, and to the because if the responsibility is shared by the both parties, and then the cost goes down, right? And I believe that document also based on the both parties sharing, because it's a government entity, right? That's the answer I can give, because I have not gone through the document, frankly.
Noted. And one more question from Manoj. He's asking, what is the procurement route under facility management?
Facility management. The sense, again, it's like a services, right? And 1 minute. Okay, when it comes to the facility management, I think we can use the, that's a good question, maybe call of contracts, something like, because the you cannot use the normal, the depend on the package, right? Now, if you get the facility management, I mean, it's a services, right? Building management services, right? Then prepare the tender properly, right? And you can use the this one of the blanket contract or the not the blanket contract continuation of contracts, because if you look at the traditional path. That's a good question. You and I never come across management contracting. I have to come back that one because I have not come across facility management contracts. Definitely, I will answer that question separately.
Not in Ms. Lokita. So, Manoj, in due time, we will notify once we get a comprehensive answer.
Yeah.
All right. There are a number of questions piling up in the chat box. I'll move to one more. What is the procurement route under facility management is the one that I have asked, and what are the forms of contracts used for management contract is another one from one participant.
Okay, I'll answer that one. Like management contracting, if you look at my definition, right, the MC on standard contract, joint contracts, because management contracting is used in mainly in the UK, right? And they have used the JCT UK based or bespoke. Now we are doing the management contracting ourselves, but we are using our bespoke contracts. In the same time, you can use the professional service agreement as well from the white book, because it's the contract between the client and the management contractor. It is providing the services. So you can use the FIDIC white book, you can use it. But in UK and the study purpose, they have clearly mentioned they are using the joint contract, JCT, bespoke contract, JCT contracts. Or you can use a bespoke contract. That's what we are using currently.
Okay. Anyone who's having any questions, you can raise your hand. Medium could either be English or Sinhala. There's no hard and fast rule in terms of the language. So I'll draw one off question, Ms. Lokita. This has been asked by many of my friends and colleagues.
Yeah.
I'll put it in a Sinhala medium. සාමාන්‍යයෙන් RICS හරි AIQS හරි APC process එකේ ඉන්න candidates ලා webinar එකක් use කරන්න පුළුවන් CPD record එකක් විදියට. එහෙම record කරනවා නම් මොකද්ද process එක?
Okay. That's another good question. Even the nowadays, I don't think in future I cannot give a direct answer, but until further notice, we have received the instruction from the entities. There is no more one-to-one CPDs until such time they are conducting webinars. So definitely webinar hours you can lock down in the CPD records. But how many hours we went through? 5:30, 6:30, 2.5 hours, right? And 2.5 hours. Now you have a flyer, right? If somebody wants to prove. Right, they can keep the flyer as a record and log the 2.5 hours into their CPD records.
So, any more questions down the line, dear participants? This is your time. While we await for any further questions, I would like to actually thank Mr. Lokit Karavita who has joined with us without any conditions at our very first request. So along with myself, there are a number of personalities that have actually helped to pull this event off, and I think it was of great benefit to all of us. And the session 2 will be followed, in a sense the part 2 will be followed in a due date, and we will notify in our Facebook pages, through WhatsApp groups, so that you can join in the next session as well. And also would like to
interrupt Dulita. There was another person, Shehan Jaman, has the hand. He can ask the question if he wants.
Yep.
Shehan.
Yes, Shehan. Go ahead.
I think he left the room. Okay, sorry. And Mr. Lokit, are we able to forward in this presentation to participants right now, or we'll be sharing later?
Sorry, I couldn't get you.
Are we in positions to share these presentations to the participant?
Yeah, I will convert into the PDF, and by today night, and I will send it to Mr. Dulita. And okay. If he has the email address or the facility, you can get it from him.
Okay, perfect. So everybody, what do you call, attending here, they can drop their emails to the chat box, and we can copy the email from the chat box later part, then we can share through the email as well. Is it Dulita?
Yes, copy that. And also for the participants who had trouble in terms of joining this session, as we had a limited number of participants allowed for this, we have actually recorded the entire session. So we will put the YouTube link in due time, and you will be notified subsequently.
So, Dulita, are we going to end the meeting? Or
Mr. Lokit, any more?
So, I'm all right. And only one question I had to answer the facility management. I will go through the notes, and I had to check and come back to you. I had to think what's the process. But now I'm thinking the facility management, you can prepare the scope of work, right? And then based on that, you can prepare the bill of quantity, right? And the facilities you can divide into the various areas, like VM facilities mean end up with the like lift services, air conditioning services, building control services, like that. It has to be a lump sum prices, because when it comes to the facility management, it's then you have to write the scope heavily the way client wants, right? Like facility management mean including the like cleaning. It's a facility management, right? And then after that, you can call for a normal tenders. But I have to study, because we have done the facility management based on our normal bespoke contracts. We have the separate templates, and the like we use the maintenance template. But I had to look at what is the FIDIC level, what sort of a contract we had to use. So. Currently we are using the maintenance contract, so that is our bespoke, right? And then we give the scope of work, and then we categorize the one by one, like services, sectors, and then we give a large description. And the long term, it's a 3-year maintenance contract, and then you can sign. But the competition is among the parties, right? But however, I had to read more, and I had to get back. I think that's it for today. I hope we all enjoyed, and I learned, the practical experience I talk about, and most of the procurement method we have used. So I have the hands-on experience, especially the design and build. And but when you go for interviews, traditional method you all know, but in addition to that, especially the design and build, two-stage tendering, at least touch, Okay, that's a special area because even many people, they don't have experience. They are trying to ask questions related to especially the how to evaluate the design and build contracts or the tenders. So I will explain that in the tendering process in the next time. Okay, thank you very much.
All right, well noted, Mr. Lokit. Thanks a lot for your time being. We have thoroughly enjoyed it, and I'm pretty sure that the participants have learned so many things out from the 2.5 hours we spent. So to conclude, I would be failing in my duties if I do not mention the excellent organizing team that is right behind us. A special thanks should go to Supun and SLQS UAE team, who has been right behind helping all of us, and CyberQS team as well. We should also thank them for organizing excellent webinars in the last week, and I'm pretty sure that they will continue to organize many events in coming days. So the session 2 will be followed in next few weeks, and we will inform subsequently. So until next time, be safe, guys, and take care. Good night.
Good night. Thank you.